We pray it all in his name. Amen. Awesome. So we're going to be in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 7 through, let's go all the way to 17. I'm going to read it in a paraphrase, and we'll see how that goes, and then we'll get into word for word, so we're not getting too crazy. You're like, man, transition happened, they're already moving to paraphrases. I can see where this is going. But 1 Peter 3, this is in the message, and it goes as follows. Summarizing, summing it all up, be agreeable, be sympathetic, be loving, be compassionate, be humble. That goes for all of you, no exceptions, no retaliation, no sharp-tongued sarcasm, which is a bummer. Instead, bless. That is your job, to bless. You'll be a blessing, and you will also get a blessing. Whoever wants to embrace life and to see the day fill up with good, here's what to do. Say nothing evil or hurtful. Snub evil and cultivate good. Run after peace for all your worth. God looks on all of this with approval, listening and responding well to what he's asked. But he turns his back on those who do evil. If with your heart and soul you're doing good, do you think you can be stopped? If even you suffer for it, you're still better off. Don't give the opposition a second thought. Through thick and thin, keep your hearts at attention in adoration before Christ, your master. Be ready to speak up and tell anyone who asks why you're living the way you are, and always with the utmost courtesy. Keep your clear conscience before God so that when people throw mud at you, none of it will stick. They'll end up realizing that they're the ones who need a bath. It's better to suffer for doing good, if that's what God wants, than to be punished for doing bad. And none of you texted me while I was reading this. I was like expecting calls and texts. I'm just rambling a lot today. The absolute closest I got to Chris like full on snapping at me. And I've done a lot to that poor guy. It was actually Austin's like weekend where we were meeting with him and interviewing him, and he was like checking out our church. And so Austin and Chris and I were in the car, and Chris got pulled over in Sandpoint. And so he's like getting a ticket. And Chris is like a techie, and so he had all of his insurance stuff on his phone. And so I'm sitting in the backseat of Chris's car, and Chris is trying to show the police officer his insurance stuff, and I'm like, loser, sucker, haha. And Chris is like, hold on one second, speaking to the police officer, he's like, buddy, that's when I knew. Too far. So I was expecting that. All right, so let's jump in. This is going to be the ESV version, and we'll just jump in from the beginning and go word through this. So Peter says, finally. And if you've been with us the last few weeks, you know that Peter has really drug us through a lot of really hard teaching. And it begins with three different ways to submit to institutions, to authority that is in our world that Peter says God has placed there, whether they're good or bad, whether they feel tyrannical or not, whether we think they're deserving of our submission or not. Peter is saying that we need to submit. Thank you, BJ. See the text. All right, Jonah, thank you. Airplane mode, stinkers. So, Peter says, in light of all of that, submitting to government, submitting to people who are in authority over you, submitting wives and husbands one unto another, finally, in light of that, he says the following. And this word, finally, is the word that we get telescope from. It's telos. And if you've ever watched like an old pirate film, those old telescopes that like extend, that's the idea of this word. This is the full extension. This is the unfolding all of it. This is the most powerful of all of these teachings, all of those built up to this, that all of you need to have these things within you. Unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, a tender heart, and a humble mind. And so Peter just dives into some of these things. And it's pretty interesting if you're like me and you just don't feel much. My wife was actually just making fun of me during worship about this, but I just don't feel a lot. And some of you are very emotional, and God bless you, and I don't understand that at all, and I just don't feel a ton. And so it's very challenging for me, and maybe it is for some of you too, when Scripture commands you to have feelings. When Scripture commands you to have certain characteristics of the heart, if you're anything like me, you're like, well, how do I do that? Like, just give me a list of to-dos, God. I'll fill them for you. Thank you very much. And this kind of teaching knocks us flat on our face, because how do we conjure up emotion? How do we pretend to be compassionate or empathetic? Or how do we pretend to have brotherly love? It's something that immediately kind of just knocks us down on our feet, and makes us dependent one more time on the Spirit that lives within us believers. And so immediately when Peter begins with finally, we know like this is going to be the hardest of all of these teachings. All of those hard teachings have actually built up to this pinnacle of teaching, that all of us, no matter what position we're in, of authority or non-authority, of husband or wife or single or married, whether we're part of the government or submitting to the government, this is for us. All of you have unity of mind, sympathy, brotherly love, tender heart, and a humble mind. How many of you guys are just really excited for spring? I don't know about you guys. I'm a gardening nerd. I know that probably like demotes me in some of you manly men's eyes. That's all right. I can deal with it. But I love gardening, and this time of year, the tulips are coming up, right? And I replanted almost all of our tulips to hide them from the deer that inevitably just massacre them. And so the spring has been fun because I totally forgot where these tulips were. And I'm like, there's a tulip, and there's a tulip. Tessa, there's a tulip. And Tessa's like, who cares? And I'm like, I care. This guy cares. And the crazy thing is that these tulip bulbs, they have existed in the ground for the last 12 months, but they've been hidden. They've been under the earth, and only now are they beginning to protrude above the surface, and they'll turn into these beautiful flowers, and it's this wonderful first sign of spring. And what Peter here is dealing with is he's dealing with interior things, like those bulbs that lay dormant for the last year. Peter's saying you need to have these things within you. They're inner, they're invisible, and nevertheless, God is commanding you to have these. And quite clearly, when we read that, we begin to understand only by dependence upon the Spirit of God can I actually have these qualities in my heart. And so he begins with this unity of mind. This word can be translated as harmonious. It's this, we're at the same place within the position of our hearts in accordance to God and our accordance to the understanding of God's will and to our mutual submission to one another as a body, and we're all going in the same direction, which is exactly what God is calling our church to do, is to all of us, from the leadership down to you, take stock. Are you in? Are you willing to go on this crazy journey that God is calling us to do? Because we need harmony in order to do it. If you're pulling in a different direction, if you're just going to be here to fight us and to get your way instead of our way, that simply will not work. And so Peter here and in many other passages in Scripture, we see authors calling us to harmony, to unity, to have one purpose, to be of one accord as a body of believers, because we simply don't have time to have infighting and bickering. We have a mission and a purpose to do in this world, and it begins with us being in harmony with one another. Next up, Peter commands us to have sympathy. This is feeling for other people, right? This is one of those things that without Jesus, I wouldn't even know what this word means, right? And so with Jesus, I understand that I need to feel for others. When people celebrate, I get to celebrate with them, and I get a certain amount of joy when my friends and my family are celebrating. And likewise, when people are in sorrow, we are commanded scripturally to sorrow with them, that we feel for others. That we're not an island unto ourselves, that we just don't live for our gratification like most of the world does, but that we actually care for others to the extent that we feel real emotions for them. Next, Peter commands this brotherly love. This isn't this radical idea of agape love, which is most often used as God's love for us. That agape love is unconditional. It's this purpose of will love where you love someone despite they deserve it or not, despite whether they recognize it or not, and despite whether or not they even recognize your existence. That's God's love for us, that agape love. But this love is like a notch down. It's just brotherly love. It's this love you have for your family. You're stuck with them, so you probably should at least attempt to love them, right? Makes everyone's life easier, and there's just this mutual love and respect as family members have. And Peter is saying, as a band of believers, as the body of Christ, at the very least, you ought to love one another as brothers and sisters, recognizing that you are all members of this body of Christ. Next up, he commands us to have a tender heart, which is actually an intentional little bit of a misrepresentation according to the original text. The original words are have good bowels, which is kind of a weird thing to say from a stage, right? And what this idea was is that even from like the deepest visceral part of you, that you would be caring and sympathetic for other people to the extent that we come up with this word empathy. Where sympathy is caring for others, empathy is feeling with others. That there's this idea that when someone is going through something, you care so much for them that you actually feel the emotions that they are feeling. And again, without Jesus, I would have no part of this. I would not be capable of tapping into such deep sympathy and care for others. And only by relying on his Spirit am I able to be connected in such a loving relationship with other people that I actually feel what they feel because I love them and connected so closely with them. And so Peter here is saying, have these good bowels from the depths of who you are, from the deepest part of you, care and feel with other people. And quite clearly, we need to love people and be close to them in order for this to even be possible within the context of relationships. And finally, Peter commands us to have a humble mind. And there's this quote that's often attributed incorrectly to C.S. Lewis. I think it was actually Rick Warren, but he says that humility isn't thinking less of yourself, but thinking of yourself less. And maybe that just sounds like wordplay to you, but oftentimes, at least for myself, when I think of humility, I think, oh, I need to think that I'm a loser. And I need to think that you are all more capable and more competent and have more worth than I do intrinsically. And oftentimes, we just think that humility is just kind of hating ourselves and dressing that up spiritually. And that's actually not at all what humility is. Humility is just simply not thinking about yourself so much. That instead of investing the time and the energy and the emotion of all about me and how am I being portrayed and how do people like me and what can I do so that I have more favor in people's eyes, all of that is subdued with this idea of humility, and we simply care for others in a first priority before we care for and think about ourselves. And that's this scriptural idea of humility that Peter is wrapping all of this up with. And so for these five things, these are those bulbs, if you will, of our spiritual life. That chronologically, before we get into the next portion of teaching, Peter's saying you can't move on to these external things, these visible portions of your spiritual life, unless these invisible, intrinsic qualities and emotions of the heart exist. You can't have one without the other preceding it. Just like those bulbs need to exist under the ground, invisible and dormant most of the year, before these blossoms and flowers can appear, that has to take place first, and then we can move on to the visible fruit of that relationship, or the visible blossom of those tulip bulbs. And so he goes on in verse 9, and he says, Do not repay evil for evil or reviling for reviling, but on the contrary, bless. This is hard, right? Like, this is the spiritual equivalent of rubbing a cheese grater on your face, yeah? Anyone feel that way? Like, you're like, no, when people revile me, I've got a quick wit, I've got cutting sarcasm, always just at the tip of my tongue, and I would just love to unload on someone. It makes me feel so good. It's so sinfully gratifying. And Peter here is saying, no. No, because if you actually have the Spirit in your life, if you actually have these fruit that we just talked about, then you need to recognize that your exterior life needs to be congruent with your interior life. If you claim Jesus and if you self-profess to be a Christian, but you are just quick with an insult, if you just love cutting people down so that you feel better, then you're a liar and you're a hypocrite. And you do so much disservice to the kingdom of God by saying you're Christian, we'd rather you just shut your mouth. One way or the other, either don't say the insults or don't profess to be a Christian, because when you say you're Christian but you live as the world lives and you hate as the world hates and you fight dirty like the world fights dirty, then you're a hypocrite and a liar and you're no good for anyone. But Peter here is saying, don't live like the world lives. Don't fight dirty like they do. You don't have to look the best. You don't have to come out looking like the superior champion or the most quick-witted person in the world. It's okay if people are evil towards you. It's okay if people make you look stupid in front of your family and your coworkers. The point of your life is not to win the respect and the admiration of human beings. We as believers win the respect and the admiration of Jesus Christ when we fall on our knees before him and profess how broken we are and how needing we are of his love and forgiveness in our lives. That we look to him, that it is his value, it's his validation that actually propels us and not that of people. This is a massive difference between believing this gospel of Christ and just the unbelieving world. They have to look good. They have to be best. They have to be smartest. They have to have more worth, or they have to tear people down who they deem as more worthy, because this is the life. This is it. This is the full extent of their existence, and here and now matters most. But we Christians, with this invisible interior life of Christ Jesus, we know that this world is passing. We know that these relationships are temporary. We know that this life and this world and this body that we are in right now as souls, that this is just passing away, that we live for something more real and more lasting and more enduring than these people could ever conceive without Christ Jesus opening their minds. And so Peter says, if you've got all of this, do not behave this way. But on the contrary, bless. Bless these people. And when people are mean to you, you ought to show them the love of Christ. If people try to tear you down and make you look stupid, if they absolutely need to look best, let them. Be nice. Just bless them in that. And they will begin to recognize there's something different in you. Because people don't behave this way. You can't fake that for long, that only by the power of the indwelling Spirit are we believers able to bless people, even when they're evil and even when they're reviling. How many of you guys, if you're honest, there's already someone in your mind, you're like, not that person. No way. They are terrible. You know how long I've had to work with them? You know the kind of stuff they've done to me? You know what that family member did? You know what my teacher says to me? We've all got those people in our mind. And what Peter's saying is, yeah, them. Yeah, bless them. Love them. Don't behave the way they do, but behave the way Christ has behaved towards us. He goes on and says, for to this you were called. This isn't some just like really spiritual add-on. This isn't like some ultra high, lofty spiritual thing that you'll get to sometimes, or maybe that's just reserved for elders and pastors. Peter's saying really explicitly, if you're a believer, this is the whole purpose of your calling. This is God's will for your life. You don't need to have prayer and fasting and over-spiritualize what God's will is. It's very explicitly laid out. Bless those who curse you. Maybe we should be done. My tongue's not working. Bless those who curse you and love those who hate you, because this is the purpose to what you were called. It reminds me of this like ultra unfortunate thing that Boeing's going through, right? Like they've been selling these planes, and a couple of them have crashed, and they've killed hundreds of people. And why? Because Boeing didn't even build in the basic necessary safety equipment as standard operational things, but they charged people extra for them. So they're like, no, the safety stuff that keeps your plane from crashing, gonna have to pay extra for it. It's an add-on. And so these airlines were like, nah, we'll just go with the basics. And it ended very tragically, right? And not to make light of that situation, but what Peter here is saying is, if you view this calling as optional, as an add-on, as something super spiritual people do, you've missed the point. And you're in peril of your very life, because this is the entire purpose of Christianity. If you think Christianity is just feeling good in here and going to heaven someday, and you get to be rotten in this life, you completely miss the point. You don't even understand this faith that you claim to have. He says, to this you were called, that you may obtain a blessing. And then he jumps into a quote from a psalm, and he says, for whoever desires to love life, to see good days, let him keep his tongue from evil, let him keep his lips from speaking deceit, let him turn away from evil and do good, and let him seek peace and pursue it. And so here he's kind of giving an explanation for all of this, that there's more to Christianity than just abstaining from bad, but there's actually this wholehearted pursuit of doing good, of obeying Christ Jesus in the gospel that he has given us. And so he says, if you desire to love life, if you want this blessing, if you want a full and an abundant life in Jesus, I'm not saying you're going to be rich and happy and healthy. I'm saying your soul will just be bursting with life because you'll be abiding in Jesus Christ and obeying his will for you. If you want that, if you want to see these good days, here is the dummy's guide for blessing other people. Number one, shut up. Keep your tongue from speaking evil. It's better to say nothing than to say something destructive and foolish that you're going to have to apologize for later. So keep your tongue from speaking evil to these people who tear you down, who make fun of you, who love to show that they're smarter than you are or more quick-witted than you are. Just don't talk to them. Don't speak in those situations when you want to defend yourself and be evil right back towards them. And keep your lips from speaking deceit. Now, all too often, we wage secret wars with people, right? And we just try to tear them down behind their back. You say a thing to this coworker, you say a thing to that family member, you know they're going to spread it, and suddenly you start looking better than those other people. And what Peter here is saying is you don't need these campaigns of secrecy where you try to tear people down. Like, keep your tongues from speaking this evil, keep your lips from speaking these lies and this deceit about others, and turn away from all sorts of evil. And so not only are we abstaining from doing bad, but Peter calls us into doing good. He says, do good to these people. Find out how to bless them. Find real tangible ways to show them this undeserved love of Jesus Christ. And let us believers seek peace with these people. That we actually are the ones who are trying to build bridges of peace. That we are the ones who are first to apologize. We are the ones to say, man, there's something wrong. There's clear conflict between us. How do we make this right? that we are the ones to go to them first and foremost as we ourselves are seeking peace and that we are pursuing it. Why? Well, here's some examples of why we ought to do this. He offers us a carrot and he offers us a stick. Why? Because the eyes of the Lord are on the righteous and his ears are open to their prayer. We started Parks and Rec soccer yesterday. They look at the calendar and they find out when is it wettest and windiest and most miserable, and let's start the season then. It'll be really fun. And so we did that, and it was blowing sideways rain on us. And our two kids, they did awesome yesterday. And it's so fun to watch these kids because we're like 8-year-olds and 10-year-olds playing soccer. And no matter what the kids do, whether it's good or bad, what's the first thing they do after they've made some sort of move? They look and see if mom and dad are watching, right? And like, this is how we ought to be with Jesus, that we know that when we're trying and we're obeying his word and we're living according to his will and when we're walking in dependence with his spirit, he's watching us. And he's a proud dad, just like we were standing on the sidelines like, yeah, that was the best move ever. Keep it up. Like, this is how God loves us. He is for us. His face is on you. His eyes are watching you as you walk through these tough situations. It's not as if God commands you to this hard road of obedience and this turns his back on you. But no, the opposite is true, that he is for you and with you and loving you and encouraging you and cheering you on as you walk this walk that he has called you towards. And also, his ears are open to your prayers. God wants to hear from you. He longs to be in relationship and communication with you, that this isn't some cold, removed God, but this loving Father who not only delights in what you are doing, but wants to speak with you and longs for that relationship to continue to develop between you and your Maker. And so that's the carrot. That's a good part of this. Man, if you will pursue this headlong, if you will abstain from evil and you will run towards peace and pursue it, God loves you, and he's happy with you, and he will bless you, and he will listen to your prayers, and he will encourage you along the way. But if you refuse to do that, the face of the Lord is against those who do evil. And not that God doesn't love those people, but simply he can't bless them as they walk in disobedience. They are by very nature, by definition, his enemies if they continue to undermine him and his will, as they continue to hate him, as they continue to say he doesn't even exist. It is those people that the face of the Lord is against, those who do evil. The same face is apparent that my kids look towards on soccer games to see if I commend them and if I'm encouraging them is the same face that brings them horror when they look at me when they're misbehaving, right? You ever sneak into your kid's room when they're doing something bad and you remember those looks your kids give you? Is that fun for any other parent besides me? No? I feel so alone up here. Thank you, Rick. Yeah, and so it's interesting, right? Same dad. I have the same love for my children, whether they're just being the best soccer star ever or the most disobedient child ever. That doesn't undermine who they are. Nothing they can do will make them not be my son. That is so secure. And yet, it's the same face that either brings them so much joy and validation or just such pangs of terror when they see me seeing them do something wrong. And it's the same thing with our Creator, that when we're doing his will and when we're living in dependence on him and when we're walking out the scriptural call in our lives, man, that's him and we love him and we accept his encouragement and that's everything for us, our meaning and our identity and our purpose and our goals. But for those of us who refuse to do this, man, God is a horrifying being and rightfully so. Verse 13, moving on. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for doing what is good? And so Peter here kind of asks this rhetorical question, right? And it's kind of interesting to mull this over because if God is for us, Scripture says, who can be against us? With the clear answer being literally no one. Nothing can separate you from the love of Christ, right? Like Scripture is very, very clear upon that. But at the same time, it's the same Lord in the body of Jesus Christ in John 16 who said, in this world, I promise you, you will have many troubles, right? But take heart, I've overcome the world. And so in this question, we see this dichotomy. If we're following God's will, if God is for us, literally nothing can stand between us and the love that the Father has for us. And yet simultaneously, if we are aligning ourselves with this God, the God who our world hates and rejects and who literally crucified, how much more will they hate us who are little Christians, right? Little Christ is the term of Christianity, of Christians. And so obviously this world will hate us. They will revile us. We will be treated more poorly because of our professed faith in Christ. And yet we need to remember that if God is for us, that all pales in comparison. So he continues on, verse 14. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. Have no fear of these people, nor be troubled. And so Peter here in this verse is trying to remind us of these things, right? In Matthew 10, 28 through 33, Jesus is referring to this, and he says, "Do not fear those who kill the body, but cannot kill." Let me start over. "Do not fear those who can kill the body, but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both the body and the soul in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? And not one of them will fall to the ground apart from your Father. But even the hairs on your head are all numbered. Fear not, therefore, for you are more valuable than many sparrows. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I also will deny before my Father who is in heaven." This is a fascinating verse that Peter is basically echoing here that Jesus spoke in Matthew chapter 10, right? That scripture, the number one most prevalent command in all of scripture is do not be afraid, do not fear, do not be terrified. And quite literally, the only time Jesus tells us to be afraid, he says to be afraid of him who could destroy your body and your soul. And so he's saying, if you live for men's validation, if you live for humans' acknowledgement of how great you are so spiritually bankrupt, you don't even understand it. But if you live for Christ Jesus, even if this world tears you down and hates you and ultimately kills you, your soul is so alive in Jesus Christ. And so recognize that you are valuable and you are loved for who you are in Jesus and live for him and his validation. And so he says, have no fear of these people. Do not be troubled. They can kill your body, but they cannot touch your soul. And he says, but in your hearts, honor Christ as Lord as holy. And so this is what we do, right? Whether we recognize, man, the flesh within me, I want to argue, I want to tear people down, I have this horrible need to look the best in every situation, but I need to remember that I honor God as holy when I recognize it's his will that I need to follow and his love and attention that I am living for. And so he continues, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for the reason, for the hope that is in you. And so he says, make a defense for your faith. This defense is the word apologia. And that's where we get Christian apologetics from, if you've ever wondered why. It's that. And it's this old idea that we're not saying I'm sorry for my faith, but this idea of apologetics is giving a good, thoughtful explanation for why we have reasons to believe what we believe. And if you feel anything like I do, this is an intimidating subject to cover. Right, because there's people, the most accessible to Christians these days is C.S. Lewis, and we read some of his writings, and we're pretty proud as a Christian to finish that book, but we really have absolutely no idea what the dude was saying, yeah? You're like, I have to have two books when I read him. I have to have his book, and then I need a dictionary. Yeah, anyone else at all? And so, at least if you're like me, when I think of apologetics, I'm like, I just do not have the cognitive capacity for that stuff. Like, it's cool, I'm glad it exists, it's very constructive and useful, but it's not really me, that's not how I think, that's not how I communicate with people. And so all too often we believers say, just go read some scholar, because I don't know how to do that. But what Peter here is saying is that that's not good enough. That does not get you off the hook. What these apologetics are, what this defense is for our faith, is simply an explanation of who Jesus is to you and why you have given your life to him. You don't have to use big words. You don't have to have theological arguments. And it's similar to my relationship with my wife, right? Like, we're married. We love one another. But if someone asked me why I was married, I can't give them, like, some ethnology of the history of marriage and how it developed and in the ancient East and how we give rings and vow to one another. And I couldn't explain all the symbolism, but I can say, our marriage rocks. It is hard, but I love my wife more than I ever have, and it is so life-giving to be in a relationship with her. And so I can't tell you all of the background information, but I can give you my firsthand experience that our marriage is incredible. And thus it is the same for us in Jesus Christ, that you don't have to explain the deep theological arguments. You don't have to literally prove on a case-to-case basis the existence of God. What we are asked to do is simply to say, I love Jesus, and here is how he has changed and is changing my life. And so I want to encourage you guys, like, you don't have to be scholars, you just have to be in love with Jesus and be willing to share why and how that looks in your life. And hopefully all of us are up for that. And yet he tags this very, very important clause at the end. He says, yet do it with gentleness and respect. How many of you guys have ever witnessed a Christian in the most obnoxious, disrespectful, arrogant sort of way explain why they deserve heaven and the other person deserves to go and burn in hell? Anyone? And you're like, sometimes I listen to Christians, I'm like, I don't want to be a Christian if that's actually what being a Christian is. And no wonder the world treats some people poorly, is because quite frankly, they deserve it. And what Peter here is saying is, if you are in love with Jesus and if you're possessing these qualities of the Spirit that he has mentioned in the beginning, then just be ready in a loving and respectful and charitable way to communicate the gospel to these people. Share the love of Jesus with these people without making them feel stupid or less intelligent or less spiritual, but do it in a way so that they understand they're loved and they're worthy and they're worthwhile in the eyes of Jesus Christ. And man, I hope that we are a church that can do this with gentleness and respect. He goes on saying, having a good conscience so that when you were, having a good conscience so that when you were slandered, those who revile your good faith in Christ may be put to shame. And here he's basically saying, have a good conscience. Like, again, don't let your exterior life prove you a hypocrite when you speak of your interior life. If you have a good conscience, your soul will be right with Jesus and you will be living according to his will, and your exterior life and your actions and your words and your communication, all of that will like be in congruence. You won't be a hypocrite, but all of your life, inside and out, will point to the fact that this person is sold out for Jesus Christ. And thus, Peter kind of concludes this idea of providing an explanation for our faith. And then he kind of tags this saying on at the end, which seems pretty self-explanatory. It's better to suffer for doing good than to suffer for doing evil. You're like, well, thank you, Peter. Like, that sounds like something parents say to their kids. You're like, that is so inane. Like, quite clearly that is obvious. Did you feel the need to say that out loud? And so it's kind of this interesting statement that Peter makes. It's better to suffer for doing good than to suffer for doing evil. Yet he adds in this troubling clause, if that should be the Lord's will. And so this kind of is the segue, this prelude into next week's teaching, that Christ actually, on occasion, it is his will for you that you will go through some excruciating circumstances. Parts of you will die. It will be hard. It will be bewildering. You will wonder if God is real or if he loves you. You will wonder if he's even with you, because you will feel as if the heavens are just an iron curtain and your prayers are not going through, and you will walk through some really, really tough times. But even in those times, will you remember that God is for you and he loves you and his face is there and he does hear your prayers and he is encouraging you? And yet it is his will that through suffering, your faith will be purified, just like gold is purified through the flames of a fire. And that kind of opens the door for next week's teaching. Will you bow your heads with me? Lord, it is all too easy for us to pretend like we have this faith and to pretend like this exterior of ours is clean and presentable and spiritual, and yet all too often we find ourselves so dead and withered and bankrupt inside. God, may it be your will. Would you provide for us a way that each and every one of us here would be so alive with you within our soul, that we would feel your life, that we would be filled with your joy, that this hope that Peter talks about giving a defense for, that this hope would just be manifest within us. God, I pray that this faith wouldn't just be insular, that it wouldn't just be personalized, but it would be a faith that goes from the inside out, that we couldn't help but to communicate the gospel, that the fruit of your Spirit would continue to be as visible as the bulbs grow into leaves and flowers on that tulip. Lord God, may we be real and true and alive on you from the inside out, we pray in your name, Jesus. And we ask that you would help us to have these defenses. You would help us to have an explanation, a personal story of why we love you and how worthy of our love you are. God, you are so good. Thank you for the gifting of your Spirit that empowers all of this. Thank you for your love, Lord God, that when we hated you and reviled you and did evil against you, nevertheless, you loved us and you cared for us and you blessed us. Jesus, help us to walk in your footsteps as we love and bless and care for others in this world who treat us so poorly. We pray that we could do so in ways that would lead them to you. We ask this in your name, Jesus.